Hello, everyone. My name is Paul Gordon, and this is the inaugural episode of what will be an irregular podcast called Saving Liberty. The title of this episode is called Jesus Was Not an Anarchist. That's right. Jesus was not an anarchist. This is a Palm Sunday reflection, is what I'm calling it here. And I want to say something starting off. First off, Christ is not an earthly king. And he's not a Levitical priest. He's not a prophet that mouths the word of God. He speaks with his own authority. And today is Palm Sunday. And on this day, we commemorate when Christ enters the city of Jerusalem, where he's celebrated, where he's praised, where he's worshipped. But the people of Jerusalem are actually celebrating an earthly king. They're celebrating a Levitical priest, and they're celebrating a prophet like Isaiah. They're not celebrating a prophet who is God himself, who speaks with his own authority. In a sense, what it comes down to is the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law. The old covenant versus the new covenant. So this reflection has come about through my readings for today. I'm going through Holy Week, and I'm doing the Holy Week readings in scriptures, and you'll find out what they are as we go along here. And I've been listening to praise and worship music, and I listened to a few sermons as well. I listened to one sermon by David Platt, who I'll note later on. There's something specific in here that he noted that I hadn't really thought of that ended up working its way in here. So first of all, the spirit of the law versus the letter of the law. Christ fulfills the law, and thus he ushers in the spirit of the law through the spiritual king, the prophet, who speaks with his own authority, the priest in the order of Melchizedek, who was both priest and king, and yet he did not come, this is Melchizedek, did not come, just like Christ, did not come from the Levitical order, or was not within the line of Aaron. As a matter of fact, Melchizedek was there before Aaron. Nor was his end ever recorded. He had a priesthood without end, which is right what Christ had. I'm going over this because I want to make it clear, as Christ is coming into Jerusalem. This is the moment when the Jewish people are receiving him as their king, as their priest, as their prophet. And he is ushering in something very different than what they understand. And it has to do with the spirit of the law versus the letter of the law. So I'm going to read from Jeremiah 31 chapters, or verses 31 through 34. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. And here's the important part here. I will put my law within them, and I will write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sins no more. Now we go to Matthew 5, and in Matthew 5, I'm going to read a couple of verses from different parts here. And for those of you who know Matthew 5 through 7, this is the Sermon on the Mount. This is the first great teaching that he gives at the beginning of his ministry. And many of us, I think rightly, regard the Sermon on the Mount as kind of the fundamental blueprint of what it means to be a Christian, and really it leads to a deep understanding of the old versus the new covenant. So Jesus says in verse 17, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." And as he's entering into Jerusalem, this is the key moment where he is now ready. He is prepared. There have been various moments before this where the Pharisees were plotting to kill Jesus. And either Jesus took action to avoid being killed, or it just said his time had not yet come. But now he's entering into Jerusalem, and his time has come. So that's very, very significant here. He is now coming into Jerusalem to fulfill the law. In Matthew 5, verses 21 through 22, he's going to give you, I'm going to go through two examples here. There's more in the Sermon on the Mount. I'm not going to go through all of them, but these two I think are pretty key. Outlining the difference between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. In one sense, the letter of the law, it binds us to very, very strict rules and regulations and rituals and sacrifices that are much more demanding. But on the other hand, your responsibility to live Christ out in the Spirit is actually higher than it was, and I'll tell you what I mean. You have heard that it was said to those of old, "You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says 'you fool' will be liable to the hell of fire." So the letter of the law looks at your action. What did you actually do? And it judges you by what you've done. And if you do a certain action, you have certain things that will happen to you as a result, either from the community or things that are expected of you in terms of going to temple and offering ritual sacrifice. But in this case, no, Christ is saying it's not your action, although your action is a part of it. No, it's what's in your heart. Because again, earlier in Jeremiah, the law is now written in your heart. You are now without excuse because the law is written in your heart. You have a direct pipeline, if you will, to know God on your own, within your own heart. And then later he says in verses 27 through 28, "You have heard it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart." So again, you have the action. The letter of the law judges the action. Did you have an adulterous affair? The spirit of the law looks at your heart. Did you wish to have an adulterous affair? It's a much higher standard, a much, much higher standard. And it goes to show the fundamental difference between the letter of the law and the spirit of the law. Now, before I know I'm doing a long setup here, and I feel like I actually need to do a long setup. We're going to look at Hebrews right now. We're going to Hebrews 1, and we're looking at Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 4. And in that section, I'm going to give you a brief backdrop of the context of Hebrews. Whoever the writer is, I don't know who, nobody knows for sure. Whoever the writer is, they're writing to, as you guessed it, as you probably guessed it, but you'd be surprised how many folks don't really think about what these books mean. He's writing to the Hebrews. This is a book which is written intentionally for the Jews who have converted to Christianity. And if I can, I'll give you a brief context of the times. This is written somewhere mid to late first century. I'm not sure exactly when. During that period of time, you didn't have a New Testament. You did have the Old Testament. You had something called the Septuagint, probably not pronouncing that right, the Greek translation of what we now have as the Old Testament. And the Hebrews would most assuredly know the Septuagint. And the book of Hebrews is basically the case for Christ, an explanation of the new covenant versus the old covenant that only uses the Old Testament to back it up. As a matter of fact, any Christian who has any significant understanding of Scripture, and I'm not a biblical scholar, but I have enough of an understanding to know that you can witness Christ, you can describe Christ, you can describe the new covenant, you can describe Christianity as opposed to Judaism, you or the old covenant, new covenant, you can describe that just with the Old Testament alone. And that's what Hebrews does. So it's in this context that they begin to describe the nature of Christ. And they go through, and I'm going to argue with you that they outline, he's a prophet. He's not like any other prophet. He's the king. He's not like any other king. And he's the priest, but he's not like any other priest. First of all, long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. He's singled out there. He's set apart. He's not just one of the prophets. He's the Son of God. And as the Son of God, he has all the authority of the Father. He speaks with his own authority. And it continues, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. Now, if you walk that through, if he created the world through Christ, Christ essentially created the world. And you see that in John chapter 1, where John is describing Christ. In the beginning was the Word. Christ is the Word that spoke existence into being. So this is a king unlike any other king. This is a king who commands his own authority. But what kind of kingdom is being described here? It's a spiritual kingdom, which we'll get to later. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. The exact imprint of his nature. If you understand the mystery of the Trinity, you understand that you have the Father, you have the Son, you have the Holy Spirit. The three are one, and the one are three. However, what's always left out is that the one of the three is all of the three. So Christ has all the attributes of all three. The Holy Spirit has all the attributes of all three. The Father has all of the attributes of all three. So the Son, Christ the Son, has all of the attributes. He is God all by himself. The Holy Spirit is God all by himself. The Father is God all by himself, yet there's only one God. I don't know, if Christ doesn't come back for another 1,000 years, it'll be 1,000 more years until we figure that one out. And I'm not sure, you know, once we enter into the kingdom of heaven, that long sanctification process, we're actually in God's presence, if we ever get to a full understanding of that, I don't know. So I'm going to continue here with Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. This is how Christ's ministry begins. He goes into the desert, and he fasts and he prays for 40 days. I won't get in. There's a whole other, I could do a whole riff on that, but I won't get into that now because I don't want this thing to be too long. After he's prayed and fasted for 40 days, then the devil comes upon him and he tempts him. And the way that the devil tempts him reveals something significant about the nature of Christ himself. So we'll begin here. So then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And this is the prophet. This is the prophet speaking the bread of life. And the tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." The mouth of God. The every word. Christ is the prophet. And as I explained in the when I outlined the Trinity, the mouth of God is not like the mouth of God, Isaiah, who is receiving the word of God, and then Isaiah is just repeating, Christ is God and God is Christ. It's a very different type of prophet than Isaiah and Jeremiah and Nehemiah and all the rest. Now we're going to get to the next part, priest, the sanctifier. Then the devil took him to the holy city and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." So the priest, in a sense, the priest is what saves you. The priest absolves you of your sins. But the earthly priest has to keep doing it over and over again. This is a priest unlike any other priest who will absolve you once and it's done. You don't have to keep going back to the temple and getting more sacrifices. Now we get to the king. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." And then Jesus said to him, "Be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him. So here you have the devil. What did he show him? He showed him all the kingdoms of the world, all of the earthly kingdoms with their earthly armies and kings and walls, citadels. And Christ came to preach the kingdom. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That's how he begins his ministry. But the kingdom of God is none of that. It's not. It's not a physical citadel. It's not physical armies. It's not physical kingships. And there is only one kingship in the kingdom of God, and it's Christ. Christ, the prophet with authority. I want to speak a little bit about how Christ is different. And this is the part where, actually, this came from listening to a sermon by David Platt today, and he brought this up, and it's something I hadn't thought about. I think it really speaks very clearly as to the nature of Christ the prophet versus all other prophets. Even today, and anybody who dares speak, maybe dares is not the right word, who speaks, who is led to speak about the Word of God, who is, you know, even if you hear something, which I've never experienced, where you actually hear the Word of God and you repeat what the Word of God says, you got to remember the donkey in Numbers 22. And this is Numbers 22, verses 22 through 30. But God's anger was kindled because he went, and the angel of the Lord took his stand in the way as his adversary. Now, when he was riding on the donkey, and he, by the way, is Balaam, and Balaam is being commanded to curse the Israelites. And God's not cool with that. And the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand. And the donkey turned aside out of the road and went into the field. And Balaam struck the donkey to turn her into the road. Then the angel of the Lord stood in a narrow path between the vineyards, with a wall on either side. And when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, she pushed against the wall and pressed Balaam's foot against the wall. So he struck her again. Then the angel of the Lord went ahead and stood in a narrow place, where there was no way to turn either to the right or to the left. And when the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, she lay down under Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he struck the donkey with his staff. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and she said to Balaam, "What have I done to you that you have struck me these three times?" Now, folks, the donkey didn't suddenly develop human sentience and understanding here. This is actually, I would liken this to the Lord is using the symbolism of the donkey, and literally, the donkey is almost like a speaker. God speaks, and out of the donkey's mouth comes God's voice, in a sense. And Balaam said to the donkey, "Because you have made me a fool of me, I wish I had a sword in hand, for then I would kill you." And the donkey said to Balaam, "Am I not your donkey on which you have ridden all your life long to this day? Is it my happy habit to treat you this way?" And he said, "No." Now, that whole passage there really illustrates prophets are mouthpieces. I'm not undervaluing prophets, and not recognizing the fruit of their faith. But at the end of the day, prophets are mouthpieces. Now, it's very different with Christ as a prophet. So I'm going to go to Jeremiah 6. God, through his prophet, speaks about the ills of a greedy people who have forgotten how much the poor and orphan mattered to him. The stench of injustice has become unbearable. For God, it is time to act. The key part is God, through his prophet, speaks. Through his prophet, speaks. Isaiah 6, "And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' And I said, 'Here I am, send me.' And he said, 'Go and say to this people,'" and then there's a whole list that God commands Isaiah to tell the people. Isaiah 40, "A voice cries, 'In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be filled up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." And the mouth of the Lord, by the way, this is a prophecy. A few hundred years before it happened, it's a prophecy for the coming of John the Baptist. So let's go to John chapter 1, and we're going to read verses 19 through 28. John chapter 1, 19 through 28. "And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, 'Who are you?' he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, 'I am not the Christ.' And they asked him, 'What then? Are you Elijah?' He said, 'I am not.' 'Are you the prophet?' And he answered, 'No.' So they said to him, 'Well, who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us.' 'What do you say about yourself?' He said," this is the key part here, "'I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness.'" He's referring to Isaiah 40 that we just read there. "'Make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said.' Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Then why are you baptized? Why are you baptizing if you were neither the Christ nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one who you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These took place, you know, well, I won't read chapter, verse 28. And I'm going to go to Matthew 7. And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowd were astonished at his teaching. And here's the key part. By the way, I want to Matthew 27. This is the end. Matthew 7. This is the end of the Sermon on the Mount. After he said all this stuff, including, you know, he's talking about the old and the new covenant. He's talking about the whole thing changing. And they know it. They get that he's saying something different. And they say the crowds were astonished at his teaching. And this is the key part. For he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes, right? Or their prophets. Christ was not a prophet who spoke simply what the Lord told him. Christ spoke with authority. For Christ is the Father is Christ, and Christ is still distinct. Mark chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. Again, and immediately there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you done with us, Jesus of Nazareth? How have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him. He's rebuking the evil spirit. "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, and listen very carefully here, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. And at once, his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding regions of Galilee. Again, a very different prophet than the prophets that came before him. Now, how about Christ, the fulfilled? It kind of works together here, and you'll see why. But this is the fulfilled priest and king, because he's a priest in the order of Melchizedek. And I don't know how many of you know anything about Melchizedek, but one of the things that a lot of people often forget about Melchizedek is Melchizedek was a very different priest. He was, and to put some seriousness to how different Melchizedek from what was from other priests, we can look at Saul. And when Saul is about ready to go into battle, Samuel tells him that, you know, wait, and Samuel is actually going to do the priest duty, which is to do the sacrifices before the battle. And Saul doesn't wait. And Saul assumes duty of both priest and king. I think that's a fundamental violation of the authority that God gave to Saul. He went well outside the bounds that God gave him. And it basically, that was it for Saul. It just goes downhill from that moment on. So this idea of the priest and the king being together in one is extremely, I say, frowned upon. But yet here we have, from Genesis chapter 14, verses 17 through 24, a very different kind of priest. After his return, and this is Abraham, from the defeat of Chedorlaomer, I don't know how to pronounce that, and the kings who were with him, this is Abraham that's going to meet here with Salem. The king of Solomon went out to meet him at the Valley of Shaveh, that is the king's valley, and Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. Now, think about that. Melchizedek, there's the key part. He is the king of Salem. You get a little bit more in a little second here about what that means. brought out the bread and the wine. You get the symbolism there, right? Bread and wine, you know, Christ, bread and wine, body, blood. He was priest of God Most High. Melchizedek is from Salem, okay? He's not traveling with Abraham. The Israelites don't even exist yet. And he blessed him and said, "Blessed be Abraham by God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands." And now listen to this part. And Abram, he's not even Abraham yet, he's Abram still, gave him a tenth of everything. That's a tithe. And the king of Sodom said to Abram, "Give me the persons, but take the goods for yourself." But Abram said to the king of Sodom, "I have lifted my hand to the Lord." Okay, I won't read the rest there. Now we're going to get to Hebrews 7, because Hebrews 7, again, remember I told you the context of Hebrews and what Hebrews is all about. It's all about using the Old Testament to show the Hebrews that Christ is who Christ is, and that this is, that, you know, explaining the new covenant to the Hebrews. So this is Hebrews 7. I may skip through parts here, but we're 1 through 28 here is what we're looking at. "For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him." Yeah, he came out with the bread and wine. "And to him Abraham appointed a tenth part of everything." He is first, by translation of his name, Melchizedek, king of righteousness, and then he is also king of Salem. Peace. I mean, Melchizedek is absolutely a key shadow of Christ, a portent of things to come, if you will. "He is without father or mother or genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but resembling the Son of God, he continues a priest forever. See how great this man was to whom Abraham the patriarch gave a tenth of the spoils." And I really like this part. "And those descendants of Levi who received the priestly office have a commandment in the law to take tithes from the people, that is, from their brothers, though these are also descended from Abraham. But this man, who does not have his descent from them, received tithes from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. It is beyond dispute that the inferior is blessed by the superior. In the one case, tithes are received by mortal men, but in the other case, by one of whom it is testified that he lives." And this is the great part here. "One might even say that Levi himself, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, for he was still in the loins of his ancestors when Melchizedek met him." So that shows you the significance of Melchizedek. Melchizedek, the symbol of really, you have Melchizedek, who is the priest and the king, and you'll never have another priest or king. Saul assumed the duty of priest and king at one point, and he paid a really heavy price for it. And Christ has come along, and now he is both priest and king. And, you know, I'm not going to read any more from there, but I highly recommend that you read that. Really, just read the whole chapter of Hebrews 7. It's read the whole book of Hebrews. And I'll make sure you got one with, like, good footnotes, and you can go through Hebrews and read the Old Testament references. It really changes your perspective on the Old Testament. So then we're going to get to people celebrating, finally after all that, now we get to Palm Sunday. And as I explained to you, the Jewish people within Jerusalem, they are wildly excited because the king has arrived. The prophet has arrived. The priest has arrived. But in their model, their king is like King David, who vanquished the Philistines. Their king is like Aaron, who served faithfully beside Moses. Their prophet is like Isaiah, who was the mouth of the Lord. They're not envisioning what's coming their way. Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her." How have you noticed a donkey, her? I don't know necessarily that the donkey fulfills scripture, but if the symbolism of why God chose to fulfill scripture in that way has something to do with that donkey speaking, I don't know. It's something worth pursuing, that's for sure. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, "The Lord needs them," and he will send them at once. By the way, a lot of people use this passage to say, well, Jesus is sending them out to steal from someone. No, he's not. That donkey is Christ. That colt is Christ. And when he says the Lord needs them and he will send them at once, I have no doubt that the people that they spoke to knew. Okay, this is the Lord's. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd, not all, but most, and I think that's something to remember there, most of the crowd. So even with all that, not everyone in Jerusalem was fully on board with this, but most of them, a significant majority, were totally on board with this Christ, with Christ the King coming to save them. And they spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees, which happened to be palm trees, and spread them on the road. It was like they were laying out the royal carpet for the king to arrive. And the crowds that went before him and followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." Notice they call him a prophet. They don't call him the Messiah, the Son of God. Also want to point out here, Hosanna. Hosanna isn't just a word of praise. It means save us. So they're literally crying out to Christ as he arrives. Save us. Son of David, save us. You know, you're going to be a king like David. Luke 19, it repeats more or less. You're looking at a repeat of how the multitudes laid down the palm branches and lay down the cloak, but it reveals something a little bit different as well, a detail that the other that the last passage didn't. And this is from verse 39. This is chapter 19, verses 39 through 44. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples," because they're crying out, "Save us." They understand. They understand what's going on. It's like, "Oh, you think you're the Messiah? You think you're going to come and save us? You think you're the king now?" They know exactly what they're saying. And he answers, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. Prophecy will be fulfilled with or without you, with or without this crowd. Jerusalem will cry out, 'Hosanna in the highest,' when Christ arrives. And when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying," it's a difficult passage. "Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace." See, he knows their hearts. And he knows how many of them are set to a path to, well, to be separate from God. But now they are hidden from your eyes, for the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down on the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation. This is a prophecy. He is not speaking. Again, it's not God isn't telling him a word and he's repeating it. He knows it. He is God. And he's predicting the fall of Jerusalem by the Romans, which will happen about 40 years after he's crucified. From John chapter 12, John repeats Hosanna in the highest. And there's a little bit of there's a couple things here that are a little different, or not different. They're just details that are not in the other parts. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. So you need that context to understand that these folks, they're literally calling him the King of Israel. He is the new David. He is going to rally the troops. He's going to vanquish the Romans. He's going to set up a new kingdom of Israel. He's going to restore the house of David. And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it was written. Okay, covered that same part. And the crowd that had been with him. Now, this is another key part that I wanted to go over here. His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. And I would argue the reason that they remembered is because they had the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit allowed them to see, filled them with the truth. And the crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb, this happened a couple days earlier, and raised him from the dead, continued to bear witness. I want to point out, by the way, Christ has already told them earlier that this temple will be destroyed, and in 3 days it'll rise again. And they're like, you can't rebuild a temple in 3 days. And I understand he was saying he was the temple, but to show who he was and to show his power, I believe Lazarus was dead for 4 days, not three, 4 days. And Christ brought him back from the dead after 4 days. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they heard he had done this sign. They were chasing after miracles and signs and wonders. They didn't have the truth of the Lord in their heart. I would argue the demons knew Christ. Well, no. The demons knew Christ more than the Israelites, than the Jews did in Jerusalem. That's why he was constantly shutting up the demons and telling them, don't tell anybody, man. Because the demons are like, oh, yeah, Christ, the Lord, yep. Know exactly who you are. Yeah, the demons know exactly who Christ is. They have no doubt. They have a better understanding of Scripture and a better understanding of who Christ is than most folks who proclaim to follow him. So the Pharisees said to one another, you see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world is going after him. So in other words, the Pharisees have been trying to undermine him and everything for a while, and it was like, wow, what are we going to do now? Everybody loves him. You can't go around waxing a dude that everybody loves, because that could have bad effects on you. Now, I'm going to leave this, because Christ is about ready to enter into Jerusalem, and this is that first day of triumph. And I just want to end this. This ties back to the beginning. Jesus is not an anarchist. Jesus is not a communist. Jesus isn't a conservative. He's not a Democrat. He's not in favor of a Republican form of government. He's not in favor of a Democratic form of government. He's not in favor of a monarchy, a dictatorship, a fascist government, a democratic socialist government. He's not anti-state. It's It's not even a concern for him. Christ did not come here on the earth to try to get human beings to govern among themselves in the best possible way, to come up with the best optimal system. Christ came in to fulfill the law. Repent, for the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom. The kingdom of God is the territory of the hearts of the believers. And we live that kingdom out in our fellowship with one another. And it's a kingdom that really only the believer is a part of. It's a kingdom whose governor, whose king is Christ. It's a kingdom whose punishments and rewards are all set in the heart. You know, the punishment, if you're a believer, for not following God's way is simple ostracism at the end. It's to be not recognized as being part of the body of Christ and not welcome in fellowship. There's no guns involved. There's no taxation involved. It's not anarchy. It's something else. It's a kingdom where the heart that seeks after God has this governor from within that allows us as Christians to live out the kingdom of God among us. And has absolutely nothing to do with earthly, temporal governance models. This isn't to say that as a Christian that I don't have issues or concerns or I think about these things. I do. But that's not why Christ came. That has absolutely nothing to do with the reason why Christ came, why he walked on the earth, the message that he had, and what he represents now today. For Christ is alive. He is a living God. He lives in my heart and he lives in the hearts of the believers. And the message is, to me, I see it all the time. The message is that loving one another means loving God. This isn't to say that non-believers don't love one another. My belief is that non-believers are capable of love, of I'll call it authentic love, love that has action, that demonstrates putting others and at times above yourself, and at the very least putting others at the same level as yourself. That comes from God. It comes from the knowledge of God that you were all born with in Romans 1, verses 18 through 20. That is how you love. That is how you have a sense of right and wrong in my Christian belief. So everything that you have that prevents you from, and when I say prevent, I mean you don't have the desire. You don't have the desire to murder your neighbor. You don't have the desire to just do whatever you can do to just get what you want, and whether it hurts someone else or not, that comes from God. And the emergence of the kingdom of God, if the whole world, if all the peoples of the world were filled with the love of Christ, knew his love, walked in his love, and were in that process of sanctification, you wouldn't need states. They'd be superfluous. Not that you still wouldn't have sin, not that you still wouldn't have issues that you need to resolve, but you wouldn't need coercion. Physical coercion to govern. And I'm going to end this with a word of warning for those who seek the earthly king and not the King of Kings. And I see this all the time, even among my liberty friends. The very debate to me of whether Christ was an anarchist or not is, to me, it's a desire to escape, I believe, the truth that God is sovereign, that God is king. And he's king of a spiritual empire that lasts forever, a spiritual empire that the end will either live in or die in, will live eternally or will die. What that death looks like, what that spiritual death looks like, I don't even quite understand. But I know that the only ones who are granted eternal life are those who walk in Christ. So this is a pretty significant consequence that goes far beyond anything that can happen in this earthly realm. And folks want to escape the sovereignty of God. And so the debates, even among Christians, whatever, progressive Christians, conservative Christians, anarchist Christians, whatever. Oh, well, Christ is, he's a communist, he's a socialist, he's an anarchist, he's a conservative, he's a progressive. All of those keep Christ in the old way, in the old covenant, where this is what kings were, this is what prophets were, this is what priests were. He is a priest, a prophet, and a king, unlike any before him or any that will follow. For he has the authority of God, for he is God. He has an eternal kingdom. He has the sanctification that need not be repeated. There's one sacrifice and one sacrifice only that is needed for that sanctification. And he is a prophet who speaks the truth of God because he is the truth of God. And I want to read from 1 Samuel and 1 Samuel. And this is in part what happened with the Israelites. Christ, I fully believe that Christ came to Israel with giving them an opportunity to reject what happened in 1 Samuel. You can say that Christ is the fulfilled Samuel. Samuel is another shadow of Christ. And Samuel was the judge. And it came upon the people to decide to reject the judges. We're not kings. The authority that judges had over men was the free will of men to follow them. The king was very different. The king had coercive authority way beyond what the judge had. Even though you had, in the Mosaic laws, you have laws that could end up getting you killed, you always had the power, you had the choice to leave, to just go, to not be part of it. And that would change. That would fundamentally change with the kingship. So in 1 Samuel, we're reading from chapters 4 through 18. Then all of the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "Behold, you are old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations." They wanted to be like all the nations. And these would be all the nations that had kingdoms, because not all nations had kingdoms. Nation just means people. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." Again, very distinct. They already had a judge, but they wanted a king. Very, very different from a judge. And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them." And this is where I'm at. I believe, okay, yes, he's allowed the immersion, the emergence of this kingship among his people. But he doesn't do it gleefully. He does it, well, it's kind of like, okay, well, if you want to live in that way, okay, I'll let you do it. It's not smart, but I'm going to let you do it. And I believe even now, we have the systems that we have, the coercive enterprise models that we have now, that he allows it. But it's not the best way. And it continues, according to all the deeds that they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt, even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also done to you. Now then, obey their voice, only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them. And now this is the part, this is actually taken from Deuteronomy. Moses, actually, I think it's chapter 6. Moses actually gives this warning ahead of Samuel. Samuel's just basically repeating what Moses had to say. So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king from him. He said, these will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. And I want all of you to take heed, all of you, whatever the ones that are out there that are attributing to Christ earthly kingdoms, earthly politics, earthly governance. He's not your guy, and you're still seeking after an earthly king. He said, these will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest, his ground, his harvest, and to implement and to make his implements of war and the equipment of his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. This is not something that God is saying is a good idea. I think you guys can clearly hear. He's telling them, dude, this is going to be bad. He will take the tenth of your grain of your vineyards and give it to his officers and to his servants. He will take your male servants and female servants and the best of your young men and your donkeys and put them to his work. He will take the tenth of your flocks. See, it was something only the priest got, but now he's going to get his cut too. He will take the tenth of your flocks. This is taxation, by the way. And you shall be his slaves. Like we are today, we're all slaves under the king. And in this case, we have a democracy king, but it's still a king. And in that day, you will cry out because of your king. And when I say we, I mean people who live in this particular course of enterprise that I'm speaking to, the United States of America. And in that day, you will cry out because of your king, whom you have chosen for yourselves. But the Lord will not answer you in that day. So this is why, in part, I believe, that God allows for coercive enterprises, but that he does not condone them. And he'll tell you, it's going to be bad if you do not turn away from earthly kings, if you continue to pursue after earthly solutions, you will always be pillaged, plundered, murdered, enslaved. It is only when you turn your heart to Christ, when you make him your one and only king, your spiritual king, not your earthly king. He's not an earthly king. Christ is not an earthly king that's going to call you to take up arms and go kill people in his name. That's not at all. Although many throughout the ages have assumed just that mantle. And I don't know what fate that befell upon them, but I imagine if they didn't repent, it was pretty bad. He calls on us to live out a spiritual kingdom as believers in fellowship with one another, to be the city on top of the hill, not to be mired in the muck of the earthly kingdoms, trying through earthly means to extend the kingdom of God that can only be extended through the willing heart that has received Christ's love.